Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. So on February 6, 2018, two of Elon Musk's companies combined in the most bizarre way imaginable. His rocket company, SpaceX, put one of his other companies, Tesla's cars, into space. What? This event clearly goes down as one of the most insanely unusual events in spaceflight history and has raised a ton of questions. Some about the physics, and others about the authenticity in general. Well, today we're going to figure out what happens to a car if it's put in the punishing environment of space. I mean, come on. Plastics in space? Tires in space? Paint in space? How much of this is real, and how much of this is simply impossible? And lastly, say there truly is a midnight cherry red Tesla in outer space. Where is it? Can we see it? And what's gonna happen to it in the future? So, car versus outer space. Let's get started.
3, 2, 1, 0.
Oh, wait. I've got a better idea. Come with me.
Oh, hi, guys. Welcome to Hawthorne, California, home of SpaceX's headquarters. I figure if we're going to be talking about putting a Tesla into space on top of a SpaceX rocket, what better place to do it and out here in California. So we're gonna go on a little road trip up to Vandenberg Air Force Base, where SpaceX occasionally launches some rockets. And meanwhile, I'm going to explain why, you know, the paint didn't flake off, the windshield didn't crack, the tires didn't pop, and the plastic didn't melt in the vacuum of space. This is gonna be a fun one. Come, join me. Little adventure, a little something different, a little rocket road trip.
First things first.
I'm Starman. So one of the biggest questions we get asked is, why doesn't the Tesla get ripped apart by the vacuum of space? Well, this one's actually kind of cool when you think about it. Now, I know this kind of seems weird, but there's no pressure differential between the inside of the car and the outside of the car. There's no sealed containers. And even if that convertible were a normal car like this, it's not gonna be perfectly airtight. So the air would slowly leak out and it would eventually equalize until there's no air in or out of anything. And there's just no air and therefore no vacuum. There's no pressure differential. That's the key thing here, pressure differential.
Take a bag of chips, for example. What would happen if you put these inside a vacuum chamber? Well, in order to find out, I'm here at the University of Northern Iowa's physics department. Now, you might be saying, wait a second, I thought we were in California on a road trip. What are you doing in your hometown in Iowa? Well, that may or may not be because I lost an entire memory card, and now we're going to reshoot random bits of this video with a 2011 Hyundai Elantra standing in for the Tesla, and it's really, really hot out, so I'm just going to wear a spacesuit t-shirt sometimes instead of a spacesuit.
All right, so what I have here is a bell jar, which is basically, think of it as like a mini vacuum chamber. So we can actually set it down on this table top here and we can actually suck the air right out of it. So let's go ahead and do that here. I'm just gonna do this. And as you can see now, I can easily lift this back up because the air inside the jar and the air outside of the jar is the same. So I'm going to go ahead, oh, hi, wow. There's already some vacuum in the lines. So I'm gonna go ahead and turn on the vacuum pump. Oh, there we go. I saw it pop right there at the top. And now there is no difference between the amount of pressure inside the bag of chips and the amount of pressure outside the bag of chips, because there's now a little hole in the top of the bag. And I can see that right away. So even as the air actually gets sucked out of this whole thing, the entire bag of chips is actually starting to become in a vacuum. There's no air. And you'd think this vacuum would just be ripping this thing apart, but in real life now, it's just gonna stay like this. And this is now actually basically what it'd be like in the vacuum of space. There's no air inside the bag of chips. There's no air outside the bag of chips. It's just kind of hanging out and it'll do that. And as a matter of fact, we can actually tell that we're in a vacuum now because I can no longer lift this lid. Instead, I lift the whole table because there is that big of a pressure difference between the inside of the bell jar and the outside of the bell jar. But here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna turn this off. We're gonna turn off the vacuum pump and I'm going to let the air back into the jar. Let's see what happens. Again, you saw it initially, there was a big pressure differential. It changed and compressed the bag. And then as the air equalizes. The bag of chips just kind of goes back to its normal shape. So nothing too exciting, really. It's a lot more boring than I actually thought it would be, which is kind of a good thing. It shows how everyday objects actually handle a vacuum. They aren't nearly as scary or terrifying as I think we picture in our head. So watch now, the pressure differential. There is no difference between the atmospheric pressures, and now we can lift this bag up. And now you see, voila, we have a normal bag of chips that's probably absolutely delicious. Yeah, not too scary, not too crazy. Actually, that was pretty mild-mannered. What's next? Why didn't the tires on that Tesla pop once it got into the vacuum of space? If only there was another vehicle which had tires and went to space.
Oh yeah, the space shuttle. I remember that thing. Now these things flew on 134 missions and none of them popped. Why is that? Well, air at sea level is 14.7 psi. Air in space is zero. So the difference is only 14.7 psi. So when you're talking about a tire that's inflated to 340 psi, we're only talking about a 5% difference from sea level to the vacuum of space. That's not very much.
And if only there's some kind of way to lower the pressure in a tire to keep it within its operational range once it gets into the vacuum of space. I'm sure the guys at SpaceX didn't think about this one.
Okay, so next, what about the paint? Why didn't the paint on that Tesla, just like the paint on this Tesla, get ripped off as soon as it got into space? Well, as we now know, there is no pressure difference between the car and space to rip the paint off the car, like we may have thought. That being said, the paint will probably eventually come off, but not due to the vacuum of space, but due to a few other things. Outgassing, radiation, and micrometeorites are eventually going to take their toll. All right, so first off, outgassing is when air or water molecules are trapped inside, well, I guess anything. It could be plastic, paint, leather, whatever. There's going to be a little bit of air trapped in that, and especially with paint, it's going to be actually sealed inside it, but eventually it will want to come out. As a matter of fact, the first three Dragon capsules to visit the International Space Station were strangely missing a SpaceX logo. This is because in typical SpaceX fashion, they wanted to use a cheaper, more off-the-shelf paint for the logo, and it hadn't been approved by NASA to be anywhere near the International Space Station. It wasn't until CRS-3 that we finally saw the SpaceX logo on the Dragon capsule. But this is talking about vehicles that will be visiting the International Space Station for months, where people's lives are at stake. So NASA takes visiting vehicle safety very seriously. Since the Roadster's only job was to look cool, there was no need to worry about the long-term outgassing effects of the paint, because who cares? Radiation, on the other hand, is a big deal. Specifically stellar radiation, which will eventually break up the carbon bonds of anything that's organic. So things like leather, the plastic in the steering wheel, or the rubber tires, which will eventually be kind of discolored, flake away, or even splinter off into space. Radiation in deep space is a lot harsher than the radiation in low Earth orbit, like say on the International Space Station, which is within the Earth's protective magnetosphere. Also, there's a few good reasons why the International Space Station isn't made out of plastic or leather, and this is just one of those reasons. SpaceX even ended up sending the upper stage and the Tesla Roadster through the most punishing portions of the Van Allen radiation belts. They did this to ensure that even in those really tough conditions, the flight computers and all other components would last and survive even the harshest conditions. So it's trial by fire, or I guess radiation. So had some of the subsystems failed on the upper stage, unfortunately, it would have been stuck in a highly elliptical orbit around Earth. But part of me kind of wishes that was the case. We need to talk about micrometeorites. These are basically just little baby meteors that are gonna be blasting the car for millions of years, eventually, you know, breaking the glass and tearing a lot of it off, making the car look a lot less recognizable. Eventually, only the hardest parts will be left, like the aluminum and some of that other hard metals. But that's over millions of years. Most spacecraft have some kind of protection against micrometeorites, like a Kevlar blanket or something. But also, most spacecraft are only meant to last maybe several decades at most. So I wonder what the Tesla is gonna look like after millions of years. Wonder if I'll be around to see that.
All right, so what about the plastic? Why didn't the plastic all over the dashboard and inside the car, why didn't all that melt in space? I mean, it's exposed right to the sun. Why didn't it melt? Well, this one's actually, we could reverse this. Why would it melt in space? Space is really cold. It's minus 270 degrees Celsius, which is minus 454 degrees Fahrenheit. So an object in space will get hit by the heat of the sun, but it also radiates heat away in what's called a radiative equilibrium. So this is because the object is actually going to be taking in heat, but it's also going to be giving off heat into the vacuum of space. And again, there's no air molecules around it to keep that heat trapped and then to keep warming the thing up, the material up, and therefore getting hotter and hotter. It just kind of stays at an equilibrium.
Now, I hear what you're saying, but the Tesla's up in space, and space is closer to the sun, so it must be hotter than down here on Earth, like when you're at the California beaches and you accidentally leave something that could melt inside your Tesla, right? Well, we can answer this in two ways. It's only closer to the sun when it's closer to the sun. So an object that's in low Earth orbit at most is only 400 kilometers out of 150 million kilometers closer to the sun. Or for those of us who are metrically impaired, that's 250 miles out of 93 million miles. So it's really not any closer at all. The other answer is it's actually getting further away from the sun as we speak. It's on a highly elliptical orbit around the sun, and its furthest point is actually 2.5 times further away from the sun than the Earth is. Thanks to the square inverse law, when the roadster's at its furthest point, or 2.65 AU away from the sun, it will only receive about 15% of the amount of energy that that Tesla will receive at its lowest point in its orbit around the sun, which is 1 AU, so in other words, the same orbit as the Earth is around the sun. So what is the current status on the roadster? Where is it in space? Can we see it? Well, there is one amazing website that helps answer these questions and a lot more. Where is roadster.com? This is so cool. It shows in real time where the roadster is, how far it's traveled, what its overall fuel economy is, which is hilarious since it's obviously done expending fuel, and even how big of a telescope you'd need here on Earth in order to have enough resolution to see the upper stage and the roadster. So yeah, you could see it here from Earth right now, but you'd need a telescope that's 2,600 meters or 8,500 feet wide. But it will come pretty close to Earth in 2091, coming within only a couple 100,000 kilometers. So get your telescopes and maybe a rocket ready. Who's with me?
I just love the big giant touchscreen in this Tesla. Oh look, we're getting really close to Vandenberg Air Force Base. Definitely Vandenberg Air Force Base, for sure.
All right, I'm an idiot. So this is all the closer I could actually get to SpaceX's launch pad. And I drove all the way out here to Vandenberg thinking I had this really cool shot in my head where you could see the launch pad in the background, and you can actually, but I just got in trouble with the police because you can't take photos anywhere near the gate. Whoops. but at least it was a good excuse to get my hands on a Model 3 for the week, right?
Okay, so this whole thing was a massive, massive fail on my end. But I did the best I could to salvage it. But at least Starman's Roadster wasn't a fail. So before we wrap up, let's make sure and reiterate that. To all those naysayers who made a really long list of things that were impossible about a car in space, did you really think they weren't going to think about the center of mass or think about the outgassing of the paint or the tire pressure or the other materials and so on and so on and so on before they put it on top of their most high stakes and public rocket launch ever? Come on. They just designed the most advanced rocket in the world. I'm sure they thought of everything. That being said, what other questions do you have about Starman's Roadster? What questions do you have about Falcon Heavy or SpaceX in general? Let me know your thoughts and upcoming video suggestions in the comments below. And thanks again for playing along with me, and I'm sorry that I had such a massive fail on my end. If this happens to be your first video you've ever seen of mine, please check out some of my other ones where I don't fail nearly as often. I promise it's not all the time. Okay, but despite all the antics, I still hope you learned a lot and had some fun. I sure had fun when I got to drive that Tesla Model 3 for a week. You've probably noticed I don't do many sponsored videos, and neither does Turo, the company that I rented that Model 3 through. Turo is a way to rent other people's cars instead of the same boring cars at the airport. So the next time you want to rent a really cool car on your next trip, Tesla, be sure and check out Turo. Click the link here or in the description below for $25 off your first rental. Thank you, Turo. That was amazing. I owe a huge thanks to my Patreon supporters for helping make this and other everyday astronaut content possible. I owe a super special thanks to those patrons in our exclusive Discord and our exclusive subreddits for helping me script, research, and helping me stay sane as I tried to patch this video back together. If you want to help contribute, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut.
Thank you. Seriously, thank you, guys.
Be sure and check out my web store for shirts like this one, guys. I will finally actually put this up on my web store, even though I've had it for like a year. So you can purchase this or a hat or a mug or prints of rocket launches or other original artwork at everydayastronaut.com/shop. And as always, all the music in my videos is original. Feel free to check it out and make it into a summer playlist for free at soundcloud.com/everydayastronaut. Thanks, everybody. That does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.